I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel when I dance for Jesus? Or will you be still? Will I stand in the presence of so many?
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Once again, I welcome every one of us to our worship service for today. For all those who are joining us on our YouTube channel, those who are watching on Facebook, we recognize your presence here. Those following us on Twitter as well, we welcome you. And for those of us who are in the main session here in the Zoom meeting, we welcome you as well. And my prayer is that as we come to the climax of our Sunday service today, the Lord himself is going to bless every one of us. And as we consider this important subject, the Lord will prepare us for heaven in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Shall we pray, please? Let's bow down our heads for prayers. Why don't you just commit yourself to the hands of the Lord? You just tell the Lord that the Lord himself will speak his word to your heart. That as we come to the word of God this very day, that the word of God you are going to hear today will do you good. That the Lord himself will speak to you. that the Lord will minister his word to your heart. You will not be dull of hearing. As we hear the word of God, we will not be dull of hearing, that God himself will help us, that what we are going to consider today will benefit us, will prepare us for his coming, and great things the Lord will do in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Our Father and our God, we thank you, Lord, for this morning. Thank you for bringing us to the climax of our Sunday service. Lord, as we come, Lord, to end our service today with the consideration of your word, I pray that you open the passages of the scriptures and you will speak your word to every heart, Lord, in Jesus' name. The grace, Lord, for us to be ready, Lord, to prepare ourselves for this prepared place that you have gone to prepare for us. I pray you will give every one of us that grace to be ready in Jesus' name. I pray that none of us will miss heaven. Lord, you will count us worthy. And anything in our life that want to hinder us from getting there, I pray that the blood of Christ that was shed on the cross of Calvary will purge, will cleanse every life this morning in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, because I know you've had an answer. Worship and we exalt your name, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Once again, we come to our Sunday message. And if you've been with us for some time now in our church here, you will notice that what we normally do in our Sunday message, we normally tailor our Sunday message to follow in line with what we have studied during the time of our search the scriptures. And like I told us before, that we do this just in accordance to the word of God, where we are told in 1 Corinthians that we all speak the same thing. So we want to be speaking the same thing from the time of searching the scriptures to the time of the question and answer, to the choir, to the songs we are singing as well, that we are all in unison speaking the same theme. And this same pattern you will see as we, you know, if what we do here in our local church, this same pattern you will see that our Father in the Lord has also taught us in the church. That you see in his messages, he always take his Sunday message to follow in line with what had been considered during the time of the search the scriptures. And I pray that as we are doing all these things, it's not just to fill our head with knowledge, but to get us prepared so that that heaven, none of us will miss it in Jesus' name. So this morning in our Sunday message, we are considering the message titled Heaven, the eternal abode of the righteous. Heaven, the eternal abode of the righteous. The eternal abode of the righteous. If you open your Bible with me to the passage we have considered in our time outside the scriptures, Revelation chapter 22. Revelation chapter 22. But Anoja, can you help us read from verse 1 to 5 of Revelation chapter 22, from verses 1 to 5?
Revelation chapter 22. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manners of fruits and yielded her fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. Verse 3. And there shall no more be curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. And they shall see his face, and his name shall be in their foreheads. Verse 5. And there shall be no more night there, and they need no candle, neither light of the sun. For the Lord God giveth them light, and they shall reign forever and ever.
Amen. Praise the Lord. from where our brother have read, you will see the description of heaven there. Brethren, when we talk about heaven, it is the final destiny of the righteous. It is the eternal abode, of all those that have given their lives to the Lord Jesus Christ while here on earth, and also have lived a life of holiness, a life of righteousness, a life of victory. Even the eternal abode of the righteous, Christ himself, before he left here on earth, he even made the promise. He promised us in John chapter 14. John chapter 14, Sister MM, can you help us read from verses 1 to 3 of John chapter 14? John chapter 14, verses 1 to 3. Sister MM, can you help us read that?
John chapter 14, from verse 1 to 3. It reads, "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also."
Thank you. God bless you. There you see the promise of Christ there for us as his disciples. He says, whatever thing we are going through here on earth, even during this time of the pandemic, the coronavirus, afflicting life, destroying businesses, destroying people's livelihood because of the affliction, because of the sickness of this, because of this virus, the Lord is telling us this morning, let not your heart be troubled. My brother, let not your heart be troubled. My sister, let not your heart be troubled. Have you been impacted by this COVID-19? Let not your heart be troubled, because we have an eternal abode. Heaven, we should not be troubled. Christ has promised. He says, "In my Father's house are many mansions," and that's why he has gone to prepare us a place. And as he has gone, he says he's coming back again to take us, to receive us unto himself, so that where he is, Christ is in heaven, it will be, we also will be with him in heaven. That's why we are considering a message like this: heaven, the eternal abode of the righteous. It is our eternal abode that Christ has promised us, that we will dwell with him forever in heaven. In Revelation chapter 22, where we've read, you see that revelation came to John the Beloved at the Isle of Patmos when he was banished, by that wicked emperor for his refusal to worship and to bow down to the emperor. He was banished to the island, and as he was there in that island all alone, the Lord gave him a revelation. And part of the revelation the Lord gave to John the Beloved was this subject we are talking about today. It should be something that should not be strange to us as New Testament believers, because heaven himself, the Lord has prophesied about it, even right from the Old Testament. In Isaiah chapter 65, you see it there. But then if you come to this revelation where we've read before, revelation, our main text, Revelation chapter 22, from verse 1 to 5, there are seven facts there I want to show unto us about heaven. Seven facts. Number one, you will see the stream in heaven. It says in that verse 1, "And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God. That's the stream here. One, you see the stream that is from heaven, the holiness, the sanctity of that stream, a pure river of water of life. Then you will see that that stream is coming from the throne of God and of the Lamb as the source. Then number two, you will see the sustenance. The sustenance in heaven. What will be our sustenance in heaven? You see, in that same Revelation chapter 22, verse 2, it says, in the midst of the street, on either side of the river. That's the sustenance. There is something for us that we are sustained in heaven. We are sustained in the midst of the street of it. On either side of the river was there the tree of life. That's our sustenance there. The tree of life. And it's not something, you know, that is just, you know, just one-sided. No, it says on either side. And which bear 12 manner of fruit. It's not that when we get to heaven, we just be eating just one kind of fruit. No, not at all. It says it bears 12, indicating the variety of fruits we have in heaven. And it's not something that is stable, because it says yielding our fruits every month. That's our sustenance day. It's glorious. Brethren, we must get to heaven. Number three thing I also want to show us about this fact in heaven is the safety in heaven. The safety. There's no need for policemen in heaven. There's no need, you know, for cameras in heaven. There's no need for prison in heaven, because it says in heaven, in verse 3, there shall be no more cause. If you look at verse 3, Revelation chapter 22, verse 3, and there shall be no more cause. See, God the curse upon man. Corruption, evil, brought the curse upon man. But when we get to heaven, we'll see the safety there. No more curse. The curse will be taken away. And as a result of that, we'll be safe. We'll be safe to dwell in heaven. Then number four, you will see the sovereign in heaven. It says there in that same verse 3, and but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it. The throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it. God will not give us that new heaven and the new heart and we just live there for, no, we just live it again. No, he says the throne of God will be there. He is the sovereign Lord. Jesus will reign and will rule because his throne will be in heaven. Number four, you see our service in heaven. What are we going to do in heaven? Are we just going to fold our hand and not do anything? In that verse 3, it says, and his servants shall serve him. We shall serve the Lord. We shall serve the Lord in songs, in hymns, in psalms, singing praises and adoration and worship unto our God. Number five, you see this. Number six, you see the saints in heaven. The saints in heaven. It says there, and the servant. And his servant, not sinners. Sinners will not be in heaven. His only heaven is meant for, is a prepared place, meant for prepared people. You want to ask yourself, are you prepared, my brother, for the pure? Are you purged from your sin? It's only the saints, the servants of the Lord that will be in heaven. I pray the Lord will count you worthy to be in heaven in Jesus' name. And lastly, you see the shining in heaven, the shining. You see there in verse 5, and there shall be no night there, and they need no candle, neither light of the sun, for the Lord God giveth them light. Giveth them light. That's the shining. The light in heaven will be the light coming from God himself. The fullness of light we'll see in heaven. I pray we'll be counted worthy in Jesus' name. So when we talk about heaven, we are not just talking about something mystical. We are not just talking about something mysterious. No, there is a lot of revelation that the Lord has shown to us about heaven. And we've seen this about the seven facts about heaven. That's why you need to consider your life tonight. You need to consider your stay, your present condition this morning. Think of where you spend eternity. There are only two destinies for man at the end of life. Our life here on earth is not forever. Our life here on earth is temporal. Either you live for 70 years, or you live for 90 years, for 100 years, cannot be compared to the internal life that we will have at the end of our faith here on earth. There are only two destinies, my brother, heaven or hell. There are only two ways, way into the kingdom of God or way into the lake of fire. That's why you need to examine yourself this morning. We are talking about heaven. But as I talk to you about heaven, I cannot fail to tell you that there is another place called the lake of fire, where sinners and backsliders and hypocrites and religious people, churchgoers, and those who are wicked, and the devil and the demons and the evil spirit, where they'll be cast into forever and ever. I pray that will not be your Lord in Jesus' name. That's why you need to understand that where you spend your eternity will depend on what you made of your soul, of the privilege and the opportunity that you have today. That's why we are considering this message, heaven, the eternal abode of the righteous. For better understanding, we consider this message under three subheadings. Point one, we consider the saints' happiness in heaven. The saints' happiness in heaven. Then point two, we look at the sinner's horrors in hell. The sinner's horrors in hell. And lastly, we consider the secured hope through holiness. The secured hope through holiness. We won't get to heaven. Heaven is a place of joy, is a place of happiness, is a place of everlasting joy. But then, what will be our happiness when we get to heaven? Let's look at point one, the saints' happiness in heaven. Revelation chapter 21. Open your Bible with me to Revelation chapter 21. I'll read verse 4. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. God shall wipe away what we have in heaven, no more sorrow in heaven, no more pain in heaven, no more crying in heaven, no more tears in heaven, no more sickness in heaven, no more labor in heaven, no more worries in heaven, no more crying in heaven. What we have in heaven is everlasting joy and happiness. I pray that will be your Lord in Jesus' name. To understand this point one, we'll take it in three parts here. Number one, part one, we look at the portraits of heaven. The portrait, how can we describe heaven? What revelation do we have in scriptures about this glorious place? With this, we see the portrait. Then we look at who are the people that will dwell in this heaven, the partakers of heaven, the people that will dwell in heaven, the partakers of heaven. And lastly, in this point one, in part three, we consider the pleasures. What are we going to be doing in heaven? What do we have in heaven? The pleasures in heaven. But let's go to point one there, part one there, the portraits of heaven. How do we describe heaven? In that John chapter 14, Jesus told us, I go to prepare a place for you, a place for you. Heaven is a prepared place by Christ for his disciples. Then he also talked about in that same John chapter 14, if our brother can also be helping us to display the Bible passages, that would be wonderful as well. John chapter 14, in that same verses 1-3, he says, in my Father's house, heaven is the Father's house. That's the portrait. Look at it like that. It's the portrait of heaven. When we talk about heaven, it's a prepared place by Christ for us. Not only that, it's the Father's house. Heaven, Jesus himself also gave us another description of heaven. He says, in my Father's house are there many mansions there. Heaven is the place of many mansions. There is no scarcity of mansions in heaven. There is no scarcity. So we'll talk about heaven. It's a prepared place. But then let's see Revelation chapter 21. Revelation chapter 21, verse 2. Revelation chapter 21, verse 2. If Esther is there, Esther Adebayo, can you help us read verse 2 of Revelation chapter 21, verse 2? Revelation chapter 21, verse 2. We're talking about the portrait. How do we describe heaven? I've told you it's the place prepared by Christ. I've told you it's the Father's house. I've told you it's a place of many mansions. And then in Revelation chapter 21, if she's not there, I'll just read from verse 2 here. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepare as a bride adorned for her husband. I, John, saw the holy city. We'll talk about this new heaven and the new earth. The portrait of heaven is a prepared place. It's a place that God himself has prepared. In fact, we are told in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 10. But that Joseph, can you help us read that? Hebrews chapter 11, verse 10. The portrait of heaven.
Hebrews 11, verse 10. For he looked for a city which had foundation, whose builder and maker is God.
Thank you. God bless you. He says, he looked for a city which has foundations. Heaven has foundations. Whose builder and maker? You know, this, the builder and maker of heaven is God. That's the portrait, that's the revelation, the description that we have concerning this glorious city in the scriptures. I've shown you already, is a place in that Revelation chapter 22, there'll be the water of life there. Is a place where there'll be, you know, the tree of life will be there, the water coming from the throne of God. I've shown you already, the throne of God will also be in heaven. You know, this heaven, the portrait of this heaven, whose builder and foundation is God. And thrilling description of this glorious city is given to us in scriptures, like I've read to us. Jesus himself prayed about it. He promised us as his disciples that we will be with him in his Father's house to share of his glory. You see that in John 17, verse 24. In heaven, there is enough city, enough mansion. I've shown you that already. And God is the builder. That's the portrait of this heaven. Like we read it in Revelation chapter 21 as well. It's a place made, the streets are made of solid gold. Solid gold. The buildings are made of precious stones, like we read in Revelation chapter 21. That's the portrait of this heaven. But then who are those that will partake in this heaven? The people that we dreaded, the inhabitants, the partakers of heaven. This leads us to part 2 here. The partakers of heaven. The partakers of heaven. Who are those that we dwell in heaven? Revelation chapter 7. Revelation chapter 7, verses 9 and 10. Is Olamide there? Can you help us read that? Revelation chapter 7, verses 9 and 10. Olamide. Okay, if it's not there, are you on mute? Boynes, can you help us read that? Revelation chapter 7, verses 9 and 10.
Revelation 7, 9, 10.
Yeah.
After this, I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and signs in their hands, and cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb.
13 to 14. Help us with verses 13 to 14 as well.
And one of the elders answered, saying unto me, what are these which are arrayed in white robes, and whence came they? And I said unto him, sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, these are they which came out of great tribulation, and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb.
Thank you. God bless you. You see the inhabitants of heaven, the partakers of heaven. It says multitudes. Heaven is not just for some selected few. Like some people, people that are going all about with pamphlet and be deceiving us and be saying that there is a specific number. The Bible says multitudes, numbers of people. And who are those people? People who their garments have been washed by the blood of the Lamb. If you must partake in this heaven we are talking about, you must have your sins forgiven and washed in the blood of the Lamb. You must be born again. You must be saved. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Not only that, whose garments have been washed in the blood of the Lamb. If you must partake in this heaven, you must be free from sin. Not only that, you must be purged. Purged from both the internal sin, the outward sin, and the inward sin. Your life must be free. You must live a life of righteousness, a life of holiness, a life of purity. Because he says, follow peace with all men, and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. These are the particulars. In fact, we are told that, you know, you must be a man of faith, like we're told in Hebrews chapter 11, you must be expectant of this heaven. Hebrews chapter 11, verses 14, it says, a better city that is an heavenly, wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. You must be among those that are recognized, that are known by God, whose heart and mind is made up and filled with the glory of heaven, expectant of heaven. Now, when we get to heaven, what are the things we are going to be doing there? What will be our heritage? This leads us to part three here, pleasures. Pleasures in heaven. Pleasures in heaven. Stephanie, can you help us read Hebrews chapter 4? Hebrews chapter 4, verse 9. Stephanie, can you help us read that? Hebrews chapter 4, verse 9. Quickly. Okay, Sister Fumi, can you help us read that? Hebrews chapter
9.
Yeah.
There remained therefore a rest for the people of God.
That's it. There remaineth therefore, when we get to heaven, it will be a place of rest, a time of rest, everlasting rest. There will be nothing to bother you again. No more coronavirus in heaven. No more pandemic situation in heaven. No more loss of job in heaven. No more affliction or sickness in heaven. Maybe you are here on earth, you have one disability and you are struggling with it. When you get to heaven, every disability will be taken away, because heaven is a place of perfection, is a place of rest, is a place of peace, is a place of joy, is a place of solitude, is a place where there is nothing to worry about, there is nothing to give you anxiety. Is a time where your spirit, soul, and body will be totally at rest, and this will be for all eternity. For all eternity. In heaven, there'll be joy, there'll be happiness in heaven, there'll be satisfaction. I've read that to you, we've read that in Revelation chapter 22. There'll be satisfaction in heaven. In fact, we are told in Isaiah, open your Bible with me to Isaiah, look at the pleasure, the peace we have, the inheritance we have when we get to heaven. Isaiah chapter 35 verse 10, and the ransom of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness. You see that? That's the thing we have in heaven. And sorrow and sighing shall flee away when we get to heaven, my brother. When we get to heaven, my sister, it will be a place of everlasting joy. It will be a place of joy and gladness. There is nothing here on earth that can compare to this joy and everlasting happiness that we have in heaven. That's why, my brother, we're on transit here. Whatever pain you are going through now, whatever sorrow you are going through now, whatever persecution, tribulations you are going through now, troubles you are going through now, temptations you are going through here, they will not stay forever. This earth is not our final destination. This kingdom of this world will not last. Our desire, lifestyle, and citizenship, my brother, is in heaven. It's in heaven. A time is coming when we, as the children of God, will be in heaven. Can you imagine? Like we are showing to us now, can you imagine the joy, as the choir sang to us, the joy, the happiness that we have in heaven, that for 1 year, for 10 years, for 100 of years, for 1,000 of years, millions of years, billions of years, no sickness, no hunger, no worry. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine that? That, you know, what we have here on earth, we depreciate. But heaven is an inheritance that is undefiled, that will never fade away. God keeps our inheritance for us in heaven. That's why, brethren, we must endure to the very end. We must endure. We must make up our mind that you want to get to this heaven. Have a personal relationship with God. You need to repent of your sin. Repent of it. As you are hearing me, you need to come back home as a backslider. Come back home. The time is short. Don't miss heaven. Don't miss heaven. Don't miss this glorious place. All this pleasant, the joy, the happiness, the peace, the provision, the abundance we have in heaven, the fellowship we have in heaven, the inheritance we have in heaven, the joy that we have in heaven. Don't miss it. Repent of your sin and accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. Our moment here on earth is short. 70 years is short compared to the life we have to live in heaven. 100 years is short compared to the life we have to live in heaven. You live 120 years, your honor, like Moses, is short compared to the life we have to live in heaven. That's why you must endure, because if you miss heaven, you will cry. You will cry. This leads us to point two, the sinner's horrors in hell. The sinner's horrors in hell. And in this point two, there are three parts we want to consider here. Part one, we look at the condition of the dead in hell, the condition. After death of a sinner, the death of a sinner, what next? What's their condition after death? Then we look at part two, condemnation and damnation in hell. Hell is a place of punishment, is a place of condemnation, is a place of damnation. When you get there, it will be terrible. And who are those that will get to hell? This will look at part three, the citizenship with the devil in hell. Citizenship with the devil in hell. Devil is the master occupier of hell. In fact, hell originally was prepared for the devil and the fallen angels. That's why if you get to hell, you will suffer. I pray you will not get to hell in Jesus' name. But let's see part one, condition of the dead in hell. The condition, when a sinner died, what happened? What is the condition of the life of that sinner? What is the condition of the soul of that sinner? What is the condition of the dead in hell? It is in hell. We are told in Hebrews chapter 11, Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9. Open your Bible with me to Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. As it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. It is judgment after death. There is no purgatory. There is no state that way. I'm resting before I face judgment. There is nothing like that. There is no second chance after death. Once a soul dies in sin, dies in backsliding, dies in hypocrisy, dies in religious activity without salvation, it is judgment that awaits such a soul. That's why you need to examine your life this morning. You need to examine yourself this day. Look at the condition of that rich man in Luke chapter 16. And remember, this Luke chapter 16 that we are reading is not a parable. It's not a fable. It's something that actually happened. Jesus told us of this story. He says in that Luke chapter 16, verse 19, there was a certain rich man. His name matters no more after death. The title he has matters no more after death. The certificate, the chieftaincy title, the political positions, the riches, and everything he had matters no more after death. That's why the Bible did not even give us his name, because it has no relevance after death. The condition that I need to tell you this morning, everything you have today without Christ will not matter after your departure from earth. You see, there was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. Look at verse 22. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by angels into Abraham's bosom. That's heaven. That's what I've shown you before. But look at this rich man. The rich man also died and was buried. That's where the Bible, that's what Christ told us. He died and was buried. But what happened to him after burial? After all this ceremony, maybe they even gave him a state burial in that city. Maybe they even bought all those musicians that will sing for him. Maybe they even bought all those praise singers that will come and lead his coffin to the burial ground, to the cemetery. What happened after his burial, after his death? Look at verse 23, the condition of a sinner, of the dead, those who are dead in sin and trespasses in hell. The Bible says, and in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torment, and seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. That's the condition in hell. Once a sinner dies, he goes straight into hell. The soul goes into hell. The body may be torn into clay, but then the soul and the spirit are cast into hell. Hell originally is a place, like I told us, prepared for the devil and the angel, but not for man. But as many that we choose voluntarily to befriend the devil, to continue in their sin and be attached to him, like this rich man, to be under his control and his influence. And as many that reject, that are rejecting the offer of Christ's salvation, you know, they will spend eternity in hell after death. This leads to point to part two, condemnation and damnation in hell. The horror of punishment in hell is everlasting. The fire of it that burns in hell is everlasting. There is no courageous man in hell fire. Look at Matthew. Open your Bible with me to Matthew. Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. I will read verse 29 of Matthew chapter 5. And if thy right eye offend thee, to tell you how serious the punishment of hell is, the fire of hell is. Look at it. It says, if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. For it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not thy whole body, thy whole body and soul and spirit should be cast into hell, into hell. And if thy right hand offend thee, cut it off and cast it from thee, for it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell. That's the description. You know, Christ tells us here, the horror is so much that if somebody that is so dear to you as your eye or your hand, that is so important to you as your feet, will make you to sin, it is profitable, my brother. It is profitable for you, my sister, to cut off that relationship now, to break away from that association now, so that your whole body will not be cast into hell. Any prophet, any teacher, false teacher that want to lead you into hell, it is profitable for you now to cut off your relationship with that so-called preacher, so that you will not spend eternity in hell, because the horror of the punishment of in hell is so severe, is eternal, is everlasting. It has no end. That's why you want to ensure that anything that is so dear to you, anything that want to drag you into sin and into hell, cut away from it, and the Lord will give you that grace in Jesus' name. But if not, who are those that will be in hell? This leads us to part three, citizenship with the devil in hell. Citizenship with the devil, the citizens of hell, the inhabitants of hell. We are told in Psalm 9, verse 17, Psalm 9, verse 17, the wicked shall be turned into hell. The wicked. The wicked, the sinful one, the wicked one, they shall be turned into hell. And all nations that forget God, all nations, it is possible for your nation, if this nation of United Kingdom decide that they want to forget God, they want to forget the thing their fathers of faith have toiled, you know, have labored over. People like John Wesley, people, you know, like the Pilgrim Progress and all the others that gave us the Bible, where William Tyndale, that gave us the Bible, all their labels. If it's possible, if United Kingdom say we want to forget everything that has to do with Christianity, we want to forget God, the Bible says it is possible that that nation that forget God will be torn into hell, into hell. It is possible for a family that say, where we want to forget the God of our father. We want to go after idolatry. We want to go after prostitution. We want to go after hypocrisy. We want to go after all the things of the world and forget righteousness and forget holiness. It is possible for that entire family to be cast into hell by God. It is possible for an individual that knows the Lord before and has decided to go back and say, well, I don't have anything to do with religion again. I don't have anything to do with Christ again. I don't have anything to do with holiness, with righteousness again. I don't have anything to do with evangelism again. Prayer, no, 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 not for me. Faith, no, 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 not for me. I want to do things my own way. It is possible for that individual to be torn, to be cast into hell, into hell. I pray that will not be your Lord in Jesus' name. I say that will not be your Lord in Jesus' name. The citizens of hell with the devil in Revelation chapter 21 verse 8, but the fearful. Do you see that in your Bible? The fearful, those who are fearful, they cannot stand on the word of God. They are afraid to stand, to take their stand. They say, oh, I don't want to offend that brother. I don't want to offend that. They cannot take their stand. And you know that brother is contradicting the word of God. And you know that sister, she's contradicting the word of God. And you are fearful. You are afraid of that brother. You are afraid of that. The fearful and the unbelieving. You read the promise of God, you say, well, I'm not sure if this promise is even for me. I'm not sure if this one will work for me. The unbelieving, the abominable. You say, well, for me, I don't have any idols in my heart. I don't have any idols in my house. How about the idols of money? How about the idols of your career that is now competing with the love of God in your heart, becoming an abomination unto you? And the murderers, those that take people's life with weapons, the murderers, those that stab people, those that destroy the lives of other people because of sheer wickedness, the murderers. How about those that murder people with their tongue, the murderers and the whoremongers, those that spread lies, those that go gossiping, those that go backbiting, the whoremongers, those that destroy, that want to cause confusion in the fellowship of God's children, the whoremongers, and the sorcerers, those that are given to occultic power, witchcraft, wizardry, and the idolaters, and all liars. Do you see that? All liars, big lie, small lie, all liars. All that, you give your report to the HMRC and you are telling lies about it. All liar. They say you do your restitution. They say you make your way right with God. You will spend eternity with the devil in hell. I pray that will not be your path. That will not be your Lord in Jesus' name. That's why we need to get ourselves ready. That's why we need to get ourselves prepared. That's why we need to get ourselves ready for this eternal hope of the righteous, which is heaven. This leads us to point three before we pray. Secured hope through holiness. Secured hope. The hope of making heaven is secured. Not by religious activities, not by, you know, giving ourselves and then just be involved in all this running up and down. It is through holiness. Three things we consider here. Point part one, holiness and purity for heaven. Holiness and purity for heaven. Getting to heaven is a serious matter, my brother. Without holiness, the Bible said, God himself said it in his word, no man shall see the Lord. We need holiness. We need righteousness. We need purity. The only hope we have to escape the judgment of God that is coming to this world is having our sins forgiven and cleansed by the blood of the Lamb, having his righteousness imparted unto us. The Lord will give us this holy life, this righteous life, this divine nature when we go to him and we consecrate our lives on the altar and we lay ourselves before him, and he will give us this righteousness. He will give us this holiness, because we are told in Psalm 24. Open your Bible with me to Psalm 24. I will read verses 3 and 4 of Psalm 24, verses 3 and 4. Who shall ascend into the ease of the Lord? Who shall stand in his holy place? He that has clean hands and a pure heart. And a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. Who has not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. Holiness and purity, a clean heart and a pure heart. Essential to get to heaven. If you must get to heaven on the last day, my brother, you and my sister, you must live in peace with all men. Peace with your spouse. Peace with your landlord. Peace with your co-workers, the co-student. Peace with everyone. And you must live a holy and a pure life before God. Part 2 here, as we live that, there'll be trials, there'll be temptations, there'll be persecution. There'll be difficulties that will come our way. But then this part too is essential. If we must continue in this path of holiness, hopeful perseverance on the highway. Hopeful perseverance on the highway as we journey from earth to heaven. You know, there'll be trials. There'll be persecution. There'll be difficulties. You know, as even as we are going through this period of the pandemic, but we need to keep our hope of heaven alive. We need to keep it alive, my brother. We need to keep it alive, my sister. Don't lose hope. Christian, lose not your head in the midst of your trials, in the midst of your persecution, in the midst of your challenges, in the midst of your sickness. We are told of a story of a beloved, one of our beloved brother. You know, it was a shameful one. It was so sad, the story. He was sick, and the church did everything to support him in that sickness, to preserve him, to keep him in that sickness, to make sure that, oh, our brother, even if you are going to see, you know, if this sickness is something that will terminate your life, we want to ensure that you still keep this hope of heaven alive. But it's so sad. In that state of his sickness, the pressure from the family was so much, and say, oh, the church cannot help our brother. The church cannot help our son. Family members now came and said, well, let's take him somewhere. Let's take him and go and help him so that he will come out of that sickness, so that he will be healed of that illness. But do you know what? Our brother could not take his stand. Our so-called brother could not take his stand. He allowed the family people to take him there, and they took him to one elderly somewhere in the village. And unfortunately, that brother died in that Abalist house. I pray that will not be your Lord in Jesus' name. Whatever the trial, whatever the things you are going through, my sister, hold on to your righteousness. Hold on to your holiness. Don't allow the trials and the challenges that you face here on earth to take this hope of heaven away from your hand. Persevere. My brother, persevere. My sister, persevere. Endure to the very end. We are told in 1 Corinthians, Open your Bible with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We must endure. We must remain steadfast till the very end. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I'll read verse 58 of 1 Corinthians. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast. Remain steadfast, my brother. Remain steadfast, my sister. This is not the time to look back. This is not the time to backslide. This is not the time to give up hope. This is not the time to say, oh, I cannot make it. You will make it, my brother. You will make it, my sister. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. You have a ministry. You have a work to do in the church of the living God. Persevere in it. Don't allow the challenges. Don't allow the fire that you go through take away that privilege from your hand. Persevere in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. We must endure to the very end. We must hold on to our faith. We must be hopeful that through it all, whatever trials, whatever persecution, whatever difficulties we go through here on earth, take a personal decision and determination to get to heaven. Take it. When you get there, you know, brethren, we'll be looking for you. I'll be looking for you as your pastor. I want to see my brother in heaven. I want to see my sister in heaven. I pray we will see one another in heaven in Jesus' name. But then this will lead us to point three, part three, before we pray. Harmony of purpose with the humble. Harmony. We need to be united. We are going on a journey together, my brother. We are going on a journey together, my sister. You cannot do it alone. I cannot do it alone. We need the support of one another. There must be this harmony, this unity among us as we journey through heaven. We are told in Philippians chapter 1, verse 27. Philippians chapter 1, verse 27. Only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs. Let people, our leaders, hear of our affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit. At this time of the pandemic, don't run away from the church. At this time that we are preparing ourselves for heaven, at this time that we are preparing ourselves for the rapture, this is not the time to separate yourself from the church. This is the time we all need to stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. We need to be united as we journey from earth to heaven, my brother. As we journey from earth to heaven, as a church, as a member of this church, as we go through these challenges together. Don't bear your challenge alone. Discuss with the church leadership. We are here to support you. We are here to help you. We may not give you the money. We will give you the counsel you need. We will give you the prayers you need. We will give you the support you need, the moral support you need. We may not have all the money to give you, but let's endure together. Let's walk this race together. Let's have this harmony of purpose together as a church, united church. As we do this, how to keep our secured hope of heaven alive. We must be in unity. We must be united. We must endure together. We must fight the battle together. Even during this time of the pandemic, we must fight through this crisis together. Don't be a lone ranger. Let's walk together. Let's run together. And we all get to heaven together in Jesus' name. I will not hinder you to get to heaven. You will not hinder me to get to heaven. We support ourselves together. We hold our hands in hand together. And we'll get there. We'll get to heaven. I want to see you in heaven. I don't want you to go to hellfire. Because hell is a place of torment. Hell is a place of punishment. Hell is a place of tears and sorrow, but heaven, a place of joy. That's where I want to see you. That's where I want us, all of us, we want to get to together. That's why if we must get there together, you must be born again. You must be free from your sin. You must not be involved in all those hypocritical life, all those secret sin. Come out of it. Be cleansed of those secret sin today. Come to the Lord today. Where there is sin in your life, come to the Lord today. There is still forgiveness at the cross. There is still pardon for you at the cross. The rapture has not taken place. We are preparing ourselves for the rapture. We are preparing ourselves to get to heaven. It takes holiness, a clean hand, and a pure heart. Examine yourself. Look at your life. Heaven, the eternal abode of the righteous. The eternal abode of the righteous. To get there requires salvation from sin and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Whatever pain you are going through here cannot be compared to the joy you will have when you get to heaven. I pray we all get to heaven together in Jesus' name. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayers. Let's commit all these things we've had today to the Lord in prayers. We've talked about heaven. We've seen the fact of heaven, the strength in heaven, the sustenance in heaven, the safety in heaven, the sovereign God and the Lamb in heaven, the service we prefer, we offer in heaven, the saints that we dwell in heaven, the shining light in heaven. We've considered all that. We've looked at the portrait of heaven. Heaven is a place prepared by Christ. Heaven is a place whose builder and maker is God. Heaven is a place whose foundation laid by God. Heaven is a place of many mansions. We've seen the partakers of heaven. It takes holiness and righteousness to partake in heaven. We've seen the everlasting joy we have when we get to heaven. But if you miss heaven, we've looked at the sorrows, the horrors in hell, the condition of the dead in hell. After a sinner dies, he goes straight into hell. There is no purgatory. You want to examine yourself this morning. Search your life, my brother. Search your life, my sister. Let's commit all these things we've had to the Lord in prayers. Let's talk to the Lord. Let's take them to the Lord in prayers. Examine yourself. Talk to the Lord. Make heaven at all costs. Persevere. Challenges may be there. Trials may be there. Persevere, my brother. Persevere, my sister. Talk to the Lord. Are you getting weak already? Ask for grace. Ask for grace this morning. Tell the Lord, Lord, I need your grace. Lord, I need your help. Help me to be ready for heaven. Help me, Lord. We need the grace of God. Are you weak, my brother? Receive strength this morning. Receive strength this morning. Receive strength this morning. To the Lord. Talk to the Lord, heaven, a prepared place, a prepared soul. Talk to the Lord and say, Lord, here am I. Make me ready, O God. To the Lord, when there's sin in your life, confess it to the Lord. Confess your sins to the Lord. Tell the Lord to forgive you. Backslider, come back home. Don't remain outside. Come back. Come into the kingdom of God. We are preparing ourselves for heaven. We are preparing ourselves for heaven. Let the Lord come to worthy to make it on the final day. Ask the Lord to keep you true. Keep your hope of heaven alive, my brother. Keep your hope of heaven alive, my sister. Heaven, a prepared place for a prepared people. Don't let anybody take your place in heaven. There is a mansion for you in heaven. A mansion for you in heaven. Don't allow anybody take your place in heaven. Get to heaven. Persevere to get there, my brother. Persevere to get there, my sister. Challenges may be there. Difficulties may be there. Problems may be there, your honor. We will face it. But don't allow those things to take heaven away from you. And the Lord, Lord, dear am I. Keep me through, Lord. Keep me through, Lord. Keep me through, Lord. Keep me through, Lord. Help me to make heaven. Help me to make heaven. Help me to make heaven. Say the Lord. Say the Lord. Say the Lord to help you, my brother. Say the Lord to help you, my sister, to make heaven. You must make heaven, my brother. You must make heaven, my sister. Let's make heaven. Let's not give up faith. Give up hope. Not give up. We are running the last mile of the way. It will soon be long. It won't be long, my brother. It won't be long, my sister. All those pains will be taken away. It won't be long. It won't be long. It won't be long. It goes for a moment. All those afflictions, your light afflictions, all those challenges, your light challenges. Don't give up. Don't give up. Don't give up. Endure to the very end. Endure to the very end. Heaven, the Lord has prepared heaven for you, my brother. The Lord has prepared heaven for you, my sister. Let's get there together. Let's get there together. It takes holiness, righteousness. It takes harmony of hearts. Let's be united. Let there be no division among us. We are going to heaven together. Let's support one another. Let's encourage one another to go to get to heaven. Don't be a stumbling block to that brother. Don't be a stumbling block to that sister. Don't be an influence to that brother. Don't be an influence to that sister. Let's encourage one another to get to heaven. Make a lot of stumbling blocks and let's support one another to get to heaven. Let's support, let's hold our hands together to get to heaven. The Lord will give us grace. Everything we need are provided for us today. Jesus has the grace to preserve us and to keep us to the very end. But we must endure. We must be our own path. Keep yourself in holiness. Keep yourself in righteousness to get to heaven. Talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. The Lord will help you, my brother. The Lord will help you, my sister. His grace is sufficient. Get to heaven. Let's get to heaven. Make it to heaven. Get to heaven. Everything will soon be over. This coronavirus will soon be over. Don't let coronavirus to take heaven away from you. No. Don't allow the pandemic to make you to lose your focus of heaven. No. Let's keep our hope alive. Hope of getting to heaven, keep it alive. Heaven. Wonderful place to get to. Place of many mansions. A place of everlasting joy and peace and rest and happiness. A place of the tree of life, variety of fruits to eat, a place of worship, no labor in heaven, no walking in heaven. All we just have to be in heaven is to praise the Lord, to serve the Lord. Yes, to serve the Lord throughout eternity. I want to get to heaven. I want to see you in heaven. I want to see you in heaven. Persevere, my brother. Persevere, my sister. It will be Lord. It will be Lord. It will be Lord. It will be Lord. All these tears will be wiped away. It will be Lord, my sister. All these sorrows will be taken away. It will be Lord, my brother. All these sicknesses, these infirmities, we go. It will be Lord. Let's pass it get together to get to heaven. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Our Father and our God, we thank you for the revelation of your word to us today about heaven. Lord, as many that have repented of their sins, they have confessed their sins to you. I pray, O God, that you will forgive and you will cleanse them from all their sins in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Lord, as many that have cried, Lord, for help, for grace, for strength, Lord, to endure to the very end, I pray you will give to everyone here this morning in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Lord, I pray that the challenges we are going through, the fires we are going through, the temptations we are going through, the trouble we are going through, none of these things will take heaven away from us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I pray you will preserve every one of us to the very end, and we'll get to heaven together in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Righteousness, the holiness that is required. Lord, I pray the grace we need. Lord, you will bestow this righteousness upon us, O God, and you give us that grace to conserve it, to preserve it to the very end in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Pray that sin will not take heaven away from us. Sin will not take heaven away from us. Lord, that sin partner, that thing of the world will not take heaven away from us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Every one of us to the very end. Preserve us to the very end. All my brothers and sisters, Lord, those who are hearing me here in the Zoom platform, and all those who are hearing me on the YouTube channel, on Facebook, I pray, and all the social platforms, I pray that your grace will be sufficient for everyone, and Lord, we will all make heaven together in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Lord, none of your people will go to hellfire.
Amen.
None will spend eternity in hell. I pray that thing that want to pull them into hell to this very day, in the name of Jesus, that shame will be broken. That shame of bad habits, that chain of sinful habit, that chain of, Lord, of bondage to sin will be broken in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And I cry unto you this morning, I pray, you will set them free. You will deliver them. And Lord, I pray, you will save your people, oh God, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
On that final day, we all make the rapture and we all get to heaven together, where we'll be in everlasting fellowship with God the Father, with God the Son, with God the Spirit, with the holy angels, with all the other saints that have gone before us, where will you unite with Abraham, with Isaac, with Jacob, with David, with Elijah, with Elisha, with all the apostles, Peter, Matthew, John, oh, Paul the apostle, people like John Wesley, oh Lord, people like John, all those that have gone before us, even our first mom that have gone to heaven before. Lord, I pray you will help every one of us, Lord, that we will make heaven, and we will reunite with all our friends, with all our loved ones, with all the saints in heaven, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
All this glorious hope of heaven COVID-19 will not take it away from us.
Amen.
In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Keep our hope of heaven alive, oh God, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Lord, I pray for your people that you continue to keep everyone. You continue to preserve Amen. Them. You continue to Amen. Protect them. Oh Lord, even Amen. At this time, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
For those who are struggling financially, spiritually, mentally, even in their family, oh Lord, I pray the grace of God will be sufficient unto you.
Amen.
The Lord will give you the grace. And Amen. The Lord will bring an end to all your strugglings from today in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, Father, because I know you've had an answer. Worship and we exalt your name, O God. And on that final day, I pray, we all see ourselves together in heaven in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, Father. Thank Worship you, and we exalt your name, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We thank God for this timely message. Remember what the Lord Jesus said. He said, no man having put his hand onto the plow and look back is fit for the kingdom. So we should endeavor to heed to these words so that we can prepare and heaven and the rapture will not take us unawares in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The Lord will help us to prepare for this great event. And I know the Lord will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, we have come to the end of today's service. And I thank you all for joining. I thank you, Lord. Thank you all for coming. And as we have come today, I know the Lord will bless us in the mighty name of Jesus. Let us have a word of prayer. Almighty God in heaven, we thank you in the name of Jesus. We bless your name today, O God, for your teaching. We thank you for the word we've heard. And I pray you, Lord, will help us to keep it to heart in Jesus' name.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
May the Lord bless thee and keep thee.
Amen.
May the Lord make his face to shine upon you this week.
Amen.
May the Lord be gracious unto us all in Jesus' name.
Amen.
May he lift up his countenance upon us and give us peace this week and forever. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.